Good morning, church. Can we all stand together? We'll sing.
Thank you, Louis and Daniel. Welcome to First Baptist Church this morning. What a great song, eh? Your grace is enough. And that is something that we can all cling to, that we can all put our hope in and have peace in as we think about our loving Savior, about how His grace is enough. That is the grace, for those of you who may not know, of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who paid the price when He died on the cross for our sins and rose after 3 days in the grave. This is the gospel, and His grace is enough to cover all of our sin. And so I'm just going to open up the service. Let's pray. and we'll dive in together. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, so much for your grace. We thank you for your truth. We thank you for your love. And Lord, as we worship you this morning, I pray that we would worship in spirit and in truth. And I pray that we would just overflow with love for you as we take time to learn from Tony and your word. And as we take the time to listen to Louie and to Daniel as they lead us in worship, we thank you for the gifts that you've given to these people to be able to instruct us and teach us and lead us in worshiping you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So once again, welcome. Thank you for coming this beautiful summer day. And as you're here today, if you need to use the washroom, they're over there. Weird segue, but there you go. Anyway, there are more washrooms downstairs. And ask for directions on your way there if you can't use these ones. I'm not going to explain that. You're not going to go downstairs. So we have a connect card as well. For those of you who want to connect with us, the connect card is back there. Enola is waving it right now as we speak. Please head over to our welcome desk, and we would love to connect with you. If you haven't yet been connected with a community group or want to know what kind of events are going on or want to connect with the church, please come on over there. Enola is very friendly, and she'd be happy to connect with you. Today we're going to be having, like I said, Tony's going to be preaching, and I'll let him talk to you about what the topic's all about and go from there. We have Louie and Daniel leading this morning, and you're blessed to have me as your MC. So here we go. We're going to have a great time. We have our interns who have been working very hard preparing for Kadopolis, and they have asked to come up and give a quick announcement on how that is going. So I'll give it over to them.
Yeah, let's clap. Good idea.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Good morning. What a beautiful day this is, isn't it? A break from all the rain and everything. I'm Sonia Jones, one of the summer interns. This is
Addison Legacy.
And we also have Logan Tull as an intern as well. He wasn't announced before. Round of applause for him, you know. We're just standing up here today because we've got Kadopolis happening, which is a summer VBS for your children. We are in need of volunteers greatly because last year we tried to complete this, but we didn't have enough volunteers. So we would really appreciate some volunteers. The information's here up on the screen. For any volunteers with small children who can't attend Kadopolis, we are planning on offering childcare for the volunteers. We just need enough volunteers to do that. So if you could please contact whoever, yeah, sign up, firstb.ca, greatly appreciated.
Or talk to us after church, because I'll be staying here for a while.
Yeah, have a great Sunday, appreciate it.
Thank you guys so much. So, Kadopolis, for those of you who may not know, is something that we use to reach out into our community and also to bless other local churches and our kids here at this church. So this is an event that's designed around spreading the gospel to little kids. We are a downtown church. You guys have heard that many times. We have a suffering community here downtown. Many children in the downtown area who have never heard the gospel, have never heard about Christ, or have only heard about him in passing. And so we want to love on that community. So if you have the opportunity, if you're not away on holidays, if you haven't already made plans, please consider prayerfully thinking about volunteering here for this weekend. Take the time to talk to God about it. That's the best way that I can bring it forward. And if you're afraid to talk to him about it, maybe he's already pushing you to do it. So take the time to talk to him about it, and please consider. Talk to these fine young people here, or please reach out to Kelly through the First Baptist Church email, and you can connect. Also, when you go back to the welcome desk, you could also talk to Enola about that. I'm sure she'd be happy to sign you up with contact information. So, we're going to turn it over to the team to lead us in another song.
Well, we can all stand again together.
Even when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near, and I will still know evil, for my God is with me, and if my God is with me, then whom then shall I fear, whom then shall I? A better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me. It stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood.
Sing that again, your blood.
Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me, it stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood.
What can wash away?
the Father's heart to make a way for us. Now boldly we approach, not earthly confidence.
Wow. I don't know about you guys. I'm getting blessed this morning by this music. This is great stuff. So we're going to open up for a time of prayer and announcements. If you would like to give, you can give online at firstb.ca, I think. My stuff's automatic. I'm going to be honest. Firstb.ca for you to give. Please consider giving as an act of worship. This is something that's between you and the Lord. And yes, it has something to do with your church family as well, but it is an act of worship between us and the Lord. So the Bible says God loves a cheerful giver. The Bible says God does not want people to give out of a sense of feeling guilty or obligation. He wants people to give out of a sense of joy, out of a sense of worship, and out of excitement for what he's going to do with what they give to him, give back to him. And so please let that be in your hearts as you consider giving, and we would be very thankful to have you be a part of that as we achieve our goals here in Timmins. So let's open up in a time of prayer. Heavenly Father, I want to pray for Caden, a 9-year-old boy who was hurt in a boating accident. He's in critical condition, and from what they've talked about, it's a very, very bad injury. And so God, I just pray that you would be with him, be with his family. If they don't know you, Lord, I pray that this would be an event that draws them to you. I pray that this would be an event that brings the parents, the grandparents, the aunts and uncles, and Caden to you. I pray for your saving grace in this family, especially for this 9-year-old boy. And God, I pray for them that you would give them peace, that you would give them comfort. And God, that just that once again, Lord, that they would choose to follow you through this difficult time. Father, I pray for our Kadopolis coming up. The interns are working very hard to make this amazing event, and I pray, Lord, that we would have the volunteers that we need. I pray that your Holy Spirit would impress on the hearts of those who you've called in advance to volunteer for this, Lord, that they would come forward. And God, I pray for the students that you'd give them strength, the interns, sorry, I should say, that you would give them strength, that you would give them the will and the knowledge to be able to run this event well. And Lord, I pray for the future leadership that's coming for Kids Church and whoever the church is going to hire to be our children's minister. I pray, God, that you would bring us a person who loves you most of all, who loves children, who loves your church, and who wants to see them grow up into you, into Christ as their head. And God, I pray for our future generations of kids, of youth, of preteens, as they go off into this world which has become so dark, God, I pray that you would lead them. I pray that they would follow you. I pray that you would revive them if they need reviving and renew them if they need renewing. And God, I pray that we would be great examples to them as parents, as elderly people, that we would lead the future generation in all truth. And Father, I pray for Pastor John and Alex as they prepare for baby number 3. I pray that all would go well. Thank you, Lord, for this blessing. I pray that Alex would not be afraid or worried, or same for John. I pray that they would go into this rejoicing and praising you. And Father, I pray for Kevin and the family while they're on vacation. I pray that they would have rest, fun, and safety as they enjoy time together as a family. God, I pray for refreshing and everything that's required there. I also want to pray, God, for Janice DeBattista. She's having surgery tomorrow. And God, I just pray for safety. I pray that she would trust in you. I pray for peace. And God, I pray for the doctors that they would just, you know, you would guide their hands and that everything would go well. And Lord, I want to thank you for Janice and for her influence in this church and for how she has led and how she has served. And so, God, I pray that you would be with her now as she goes and is taken care of. I want to pray for Gary Stevenson, Lord, who has lost a nephew. Lost him Friday morning and a really difficult situation there. And so, God, I pray for Gary that you would give him comfort as well. Lord, I pray for Gary's family that if they don't know you, that they would come to know you through the loss of this nephew. Lord, oftentimes you meet us in our pain and in our suffering and in our loss. And so I pray, Jesus, that you would meet Gary's family in this pain and suffering and that you would meet Gary in this pain and suffering. Thank you for how he's served us faithfully over the years. He makes our coffee and our tea, and we're so thankful for his good service to you as he worships you in this way. And one more. God, I want to pray for the homeless in Timmins. Father, there are so many people in this town who are struggling, who are homeless, who are without a place to lay their head. And Lord, you haven't told us to have opinions about them. You haven't told us to decide whether or not they are deserving of our love. You have not called us to judge them. And Lord, I'm sure that we can all say at times we've been guilty. We've been frustrated, especially when it comes to issues with drugs and alcohol. But God, you have called us to love the people who are suffering in our community. And so, God, as we look to the homeless in Timmins, I pray that we would be a beacon of light at this church. I pray that we would be loving, that we would be generous. And, Lord, I pray that we would tell the truth in love, and that we would lead them to you, that we would share the gospel with them. And, God, there are those in this community who hate them. There are even those in this community, we've heard recently from someone who is homeless, that there are those in this community who are seeking them out to try to do harm to them because they hate them. And so, God, I pray that we would not be those people. I pray that we would be people who shine bright in downtown Timmins, as we always have. Thank you for our food bank. Thank you for Amber and for her team who so faithfully serve those who are struggling in our community. We thank you, God, for the other food banks in Timmins. We thank you, Lord, for those homeless shelters where they can go to have a place to rest. Lord, even though there are many who say they're frustrated, God, I pray for solutions to those frustrations, solutions that come from you, because we know that you, there's no one who loves the homeless more than you do. And so, God, I pray that you would lead us through your Holy Spirit in all these things we ask. In Jesus' name, amen.
Kids, you are dismissed. Sorry, I had a note on my page and I totally forgot. God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for, again, the chance to be together, to worship you, to hear from your word, and God, to be drawn closer to each other. And God, we thank you that you are our God, our King, and at the same time, you're our Father, and you are our friend. And Lord, we know that our strength comes from you, and so we thank you. As we look into your word now, Lord, may we be encouraged and equipped. And Lord, we thank you for Tony, and we pray that you be with him as he brings your message this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church. Yeah, my name is Elijah, and I'll be taking the Bible reading today. And I'll be reading from the book of Psalms, chapter 23. It's a very popular scripture. We're going to be sharing that. Psalm 23, all the psalm. And I'll read. In my Bible, it says, The Lord, the shepherd of his people. Verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Thanks very much, Elijah, for that reading. Good morning, First Baptist Church. Good morning, First B. Oh, that's okay. Let's try that again. Good morning, First B. It's been a long time since I've been up here. My name, for those of you that don't know me, my name's Tony Linton. I'm one of the lay pastors here at First B. I'm best known for being Enola's husband. That's hence the closeness at the welcome desk there. I also keep busy as our crony Tony on KFM. And I also make occasional appearances on a TV series about some island out in Nova Scotia. Okay, I guess nobody watches it. Enola and I are also proud parents to Cassandra, Jennifer, and Reg. We're also outlaws to Josh and Andrew, and grandparents to Dominic, Mia, Wesley, Keturah, Boaz, and Keziah, all of which attend here at the church, which I'm proud. I like the fact that my family has chosen to follow in being Christ followers. I really do. I think it's important, and it's been a big part of Enola's in my life I'm departing from the notes, you can tell. It's been a big part of the church has been a very big part of our family for 26 years. I'm going to get corrected afterwards, but it's around 26 years we've been here. And this church, we love the fact that this church is a loving downtown community church where anybody can worship, anybody at all. And I love the fact that I come in here on a Sunday morning and I look around and I see people that I have never seen in my life. That is awesome. And I encourage each and every one of you, just like Kevin does after every service, I encourage each and every one of you to walk towards someone, shake their hand, hug them, whatever you need to do to make them feel welcome, someone who you have not seen before in the church after the service. Okay, so now I'm going to go back to my notes. Some I have to get out of the way right off here. First of all, I'm going to apologize for keeping very close to my notes because I'm not that great orator you listened to last week. So I'm going to be reading quite a bit. Secondly, I'm well known for falling asleep during the service when the sermon is on. So if you see me nodding off, please let me know. All right. Slide number 2, please. Something that I've always wanted to do from the pulpit, we're about to do. So these next couple of slides are for the folks that are here among the congregation today that have come wanting to know what all this Christian stuff's about. And a fella that's well known in the Christian circles, Billy Graham, just passed away not that long ago, would say that the urgency comes from the fact that your world could end tonight. I'll just share, I'll depart from the notes again. I'll just share a little bit. My world almost ended in 2018 with a heart attack. That if I hadn't been in the right place, in the right time, at the hospital, in the trauma ward, with everything and everybody right there, I wouldn't be standing here talking to you right now. Now, on the flip side, I'd be in heaven, but there's arguments both ways as to which one's good, I should say. So I'd like to express to you that if you're not saved today, this is the reality. If you're not saved today and you die tonight, you're going to hell. That's all there is to it. That's the end of it. But there's an alternative that's better. And I'd like you to know that God loves you and has a plan for you. And there's a Bible verse to that effect. I won't quote it. But God loves you and has a plan for you. And the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only one, his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. That's the psalm, that's the song, that's the verse, that's the cliche, whatever, that comes from John 3:16 that everybody knows, but how do you put it into practice? Jesus also said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly, a complete life full of purpose. And that comes from John 10:10, whoever's taking notes. But here's the problem. We have all sinned, and God cannot tolerate sin. So we have a roadmap to salvation that Paul left for us in the book of Romans. And that's the verses that go with it. So if anybody's taking notes, or the best thing is, pull out your cell phone, take a picture. And you'll see the reason why I'm saying that a little bit later. The first verse in the Romans road to salvation is Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all sinned. We've all done things that are displeasing to God. There is no one who is innocent. Romans 3:10 to 18 gives a detailed picture of what that sin looks like in our lives. And it says, as the scriptures say, no one is righteous, not even one. No one is truly wise. No one is seeking God. All have turned away. All have become useless. No one does good, not a single one. Their talk is foul, like a stench from an open grave. Their tongues are filled with lies. Snake venom drips from their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. They rush to commit murder. Destruction and misery always follows them. They do not know where to find peace. They have no fear of God at all. The second scripture in Romans, on the Romans road to salvation is Romans 6:23b. Teaches us about the consequences of sin. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The punishment that we have earned for our sins is death, not just a physical death, but an eternal death. The third verse on the Romans road to salvation picks up in the middle of Romans 6:23, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 5:8 declares, but God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus Christ died for us. Jesus' death paid the price for our sins. Jesus' resurrection proves that God accepted Jesus' death for payment for our sins. The fourth stop on the road to Romans road to salvation is Romans 10:19, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. We getting the picture? Because of Jesus' death on our behalf, all we have to do is believe in him trusting his death as payment for our sins, and we will be saved. Romans 10:13 says it again, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Jesus died to pay the penalty for our sins and rescue us from eternal death. Salvation, the forgiveness of sins, is available to anyone who will trust in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. The final aspect to the Romans road to salvation is the results of salvation. Romans 5:1 has this wonderful message. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through Jesus Christ, we can have a relationship of peace with God. Romans 8:1 says, therefore, there is no condemnation for those who in Christ Jesus, who are in Christ Jesus, because of Jesus' death on our behalf. We will never be condemned for our sins. Finally, we have this precious promise of God from Romans 8:38-39. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither the present, nor the future, nor any powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So once you're saved, God holds you. So would you like to follow the Roman road to salvation? If so, there's a simple prayer. If I can get the next slide up. There's a simple prayer that you can pray to God. It's that simple. Saying the prayer is a way to declare to God that you're relying on Jesus Christ for your salvation. The words themselves won't save you, but only faith in Jesus Christ can provide salvation. So I'm going to ask if the church will rise with me, stand with me, and everyone follow along and pray this prayer with me. So dear Jesus, dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I turn from my sins and invite you to come into my heart and live. I want to trust and follow you as my Lord and Savior. In your name, amen. Into my heart and life. Okay. Please be seated. So for those, I'm speaking to those that have just prayed that prayer for the first time, or one like it for the first time. If you sincerely prayed that prayer, you are saved. But you need to tell somebody. Tell the person next to you. And if you wish, come to me after the service. Tell me. Also, if you want, go to the welcome desk, talk to my lovely wife, fill out one of these connection cards, and the church administration will follow up with you. And the idea is that we can help you along this journey that's called Christianity. And also, welcome to eternal life. Like I said earlier, that's something I've wanted to do ever since I became a deacon even, never mind the lay pastor part, for years. I see former pastor Pat smiling from ear to ear back there because that's something that he used to do from here as well. And I thank every pastor in my life that's been over the years. I remember Pastor Wilkinson from Englehart Baptist. Every one of those pastors taught me a little piece of what it means to be a Christian. And I say thank you to every one of them. Well, slide number 4, please. This is the actual sermon. So, we're made right with God by placing our faith in Christ Jesus. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who we are. Which version have I got there? I got the King James Version. Let's go with that. Okay, so even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all, and upon all of them that believe, there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely through his grace, by his grace, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. That's the series verse for all of this series. It's amazing how when Pastor Kevin picks out the series verse, it just seems to slide into every sermon, not as an item by itself, but I was looking at it and I'm going, wow, that just kind of fills right in with what's going on in Ephesians 6, verse 12, which just happens to be our verse today that I get to talk about. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for continuing to show us your love and compassion when we really don't deserve it. As we study your word today and through your Holy Spirit, pour unto us, into us, and unto us wisdom and understanding. Please walk the aisles here today, touch each one of us so that we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we've been in the presence of the one who created the whole world yet cares about the sparrow that falls to the ground. Help me be a blessing to the person on my left, the person on my right, the person behind me, and the person in front of me, not just here, but everywhere in my walk through the week. Finally, help me to bear the weight of the responsibility that comes with leadership and to always teach in righteousness and truth. Keep me from pride. Keep me walking humbly before you. I pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Slide number 5, please. So the big idea for today's scripture, which is not Psalm 120 or Psalm 23. Psalm 23 is interesting, though, how it also ties into what not just this verse today, but also all of this whole part of the armor of God. How walking and abiding with Christ and how we let God and we want God to provide for us in the fight against demons. So the big idea says, as Christ followers, we are fighting in a spiritual battle. This battle's against the devil and his demons. We're not fighting a physical battle against people. Yes, the spiritual world spills over into the physical world, and we all feel the effects of it, and we'll talk about that in a little bit more. But it is definitely that it is a spiritual battle between us as Christians and the host of Satan. So how do I struggle with this? I'll provide a little bit of personal aspect, and then we're going to go into some more congregational stuff. There's times in my life when I've been really aware of the devil's attacks, especially in my involvement of doing God's work, what would be defined as God's work, right? There's times when Murphy's Law, and we're all familiar with that, anything that can go wrong will go wrong at the worst possible time. That rules. Really, it does sometimes. But it's obvious when it's obvious, that it's an outside force that seems to be influencing the outcome. That's the times I've noticed that this most. It's when I'm volunteering for the church or the radio station, trying to set things up. Or, you know, some of you might remember some of the stuff that we did with the radio station back in the day, before COVID. Same thing happens in the background today when we're setting up for Share-a-thon every 6 months. The telephone lines go down. There's something wrong with the internet. There's a lightning strike somewhere. It's all happened. And it's like, why does it happen now? Well, this is that influence that we see happening, right? This is the time, though, when we need to stop, recognize what's happening and where it's happening from, take a deep breath, and pray that our Lord, rather than Satan, rules the day. So I'm going to ask some questions. I'm going to look for some some answers from you guys. What are the outside forces that Satan has tried to use to hinder you? How has your health, your job, your children, your finances, your family, etc.? What's the one thing of all of that? What's the one thing that Satan seems to use repeatedly to resist you?
Money.
Money. Absolutely. Thank you. Keeps me busy. Busyness. That's me. Absolutely. Anything else? Sorry.
Paying taxes.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah. Just would it be fair to say distractions?
Yeah.
That's there's again. Yeah, for sure.
Work.
Work too. Worry. Worry and work. Yeah. Anxiety. Absolutely. Yes. Destroyed relationships. Yes. Okay, well let's go to the next one. So when you're aware that the devil is trying to use these events, circumstances, or people to slow you down or distract you from your calling, how do you respond to these attacks? What steps do you take to overcome them and stay on track? So let's concentrate on that last one. What steps can we take to overcome them and stay on track?
Prayer.
Anyone else?
Be strong in the Lord.
It's a good study, right?
Put on your armor.
Put on your armor.
Fellowship.
Fellowship. Awesome. I'm really enjoying the interaction here. Anyone else?
Worship.
Yes. It's all there, right? Okay, let's try the next one. Do you seek the strength and counsel of other believers when these attacks occur, or are you just usually slug it out in silence on your own? Judging by the outcome, when you go through these difficult times alone, do you think you need the strength and counsel of others more often?
Yeah,
depends. Anyone else? Okay, so we're gonna tackle this a little bit more as time goes on, but there's absolutely a very, very good reason why the Bible says don't forsake gathering with other Christians. There's a good reason why. Yes, it is. So slide number 9. Yeah, suffering because we are Christians. So Paul talks about this himself, actually. He illustrates to Timothy when he says, "And God chose me to be a preacher, an apostle, a teacher of this good news. That is why I'm suffering here in prison, but I'm not ashamed of it, for I know the one whom I trust, in whom I trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day of his return." Let's try that in the King James Version. Did I write that up? Yeah, I did do it in King James. There's a reason why I put it all in King James, because there's that poetic thing to it, right? Whereunto I am appointed a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer for these things. Nevertheless, I'm not ashamed, for I know who I'm believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Really hard not to sing that part, eh? I saw Gwen nodding there. Paul recognized that he suffered because of his involvement in the work of preaching the gospel. He suffered because, I've got that written in big, bold letters on my sheet, because of his involvement in the work of preaching the gospel. So really, what about you? What about me? What events in our life can point to where we knew some evil force was actively trying to destroy us? Yet, now we have the tools to recognize what's happening, right? Now we have that recognition and we know what to do. We need to as Pat mentioned, pray, and others mentioned. How do we tackle this, right? So let's look at what the Word has to say. Slide 10. Yes. Now, I've got this written out three different ways, three different versions, but they all say the same thing, but using different words. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers, against darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents, but against rulers, against powers, against the world forces of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly supernatural places. I don't think that amplified version was meant to be read out loud. Anyway, but what it does is it definitely shows that there are different perspectives as how to look at this specific verse, and they all illustrate clearly what's going on. So let's deal with that a bit. Let's break it down. I have no idea what time it is. Okay. Who are we wrestling with? So Paul uses a bit of an illustration there, and I'll draw your attention to some of the stuff. He talks about wrestling. Wrestling is not like what you'd think of wrestling today. Wrestling back then was something a little bit more gory. Greek cities at the time of Apostle Paul, they had houses of combat sports. These sports were boxing, wrestling, and something called pancracton or something like that. Darn my English tongue. These were violent, bloody versions of what we know of wrestling and boxing today because there was virtually no rules. People would either typically win the match or they'd die trying. And this is how serious Paul is when he intentionally uses the word in these words in these verses. It's clear that we're fighting a spiritual battle to win against the forces of the devil, as they are organized in armed forces, just like an army that Paul describes each rank. So first of all, he talks about principalities. Boy, you're doing a better job with the slides than I would. Thank you. Principalities. These are the demons that hold the highest ranks at the very top of Satan's domain. They're like princes or generals in today's world, and they've held their powers of power or positions of power since ancient times. The powers are the demons that have delegated authority, similar to lower-ranking officers, such as a colonel or a major, captain, a lieutenant, that kind of thing. These demons have the authority to roam the earth and carry out all kinds of manner of evil and wickedness. The rulers of the darkness of this world, these are the rank and file evil powers that have been organized and trained in an aggressive force. They would form the enlisted men of an army. And finally, the spiritual wickedness in high places. This is the summation and the ultimate goal of Satan's method of operation. The demon army described, as we have, is sent to destroy humanity in any way possible in both the spiritual realm and the physical. And one of the things that was illustrated in one of the texts that I was reading about was Satan knows that his time is limited. He knows that he already knows. Like he can read the Bible just the same as us. He knows that he's lost the ultimate battle. Like, we've all read the last page, Jesus wins, right? Can I get an amen?
Amen?
Amen, right? Jesus wins. But it's the process of getting there. And Satan knows that his time is limited, so he's working very hard on the earth to destroy your life and your life and your life and my life and everybody. All we have to do is look at the news to understand what's happening. Everybody shakes their head and goes, I don't understand. Look at the big picture. Look at the big picture. We have a supernatural force that is driving through the world to destroy humanity, period. So, we have a challenge with this verse. We have a challenge with all of the verses in the Bible, but specifically here. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Where am I going with this? But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you're only fooling yourselves. So this is the concern. The devil's armies are organized, like we just talked about. They're organized into an army. They're focused to destroy us, just like I talked about. And the typical Christian, although we abide in the power of God Almighty, we know God wins at the end. We are uneducated. We're unorganized against the devil's assaults. So what can we do? What can we do to improve our situation? Stop telling lies. Let us tell our neighbors the truth, for we are all parts of the same body. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry, for anger gives a foothold to the devil. If you are a thief, quit stealing. Instead, use your hands for a good hard work, and then give generously to others in need. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. And do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember that He has identified you as His own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Let's review that. First of all, the first concept is put away lying, right? From verse 25. Speak truth with your neighbor. Be angry and sin not. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Give no place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no more. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. Grieve not the Holy Spirit. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking, and malice be put away from you. And then the next step is to put on the full armor of God. So, Ephesians 6:11 says, put on the full armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The whole armor includes, sorry, I can't tell you. But I will say, look ahead in Ephesians 6 and read ahead, figure it out for yourself, because you'll be that much more prepared for the next couple of Sunday sermons. And it's important to understand that the wiles of the devil, I had to look this up too. The meaning is method, direction, or strategy. And former pastor Aaron, also illustrated that last week in his presentation. As you can see, it's handy to take pictures. So the fight. What similarities can you see between the way that the ancient Greeks fought and what battles you have faced in your own life? When we wrestle with the spiritual forces that are against us, how do we resist? Do we fight as if our lives depended on it? Or do we back down and let the enemy have their way with us? In other words, be ineffective. God will provide the victory through His Son Jesus and the Holy Spirit. But as Christ followers, we need to do exactly that. Follow Christ's leading. Be prepared and don't back down in the face of spiritual aggression. As Aaron highlighted last week, the enemy is powerful, but God is greater. He will equip you. And that comes from 2 Peter 1:3-8. So slide number 15, preparing God's army. What we've now learned is that Satan maintains a military-like structure for organizing his demons. Let's consider then what we Christians should be doing to carry out the work of the church. All scripture is inspired by God, and it's useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what's wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. That comes from 2 Timothy 3:16-17. And now all these gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers, their responsibility is to equip God's people and to do his work and to build up the church, the body of Christ. This will continue until we've all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. Then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown around by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like truth. Aren't we hearing that today on Twitter? Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of the body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. And that all comes from Ephesians 4:11-16. And finally, let us not neglect meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. And that comes from Hebrews 10:25. Slide 16. Rick Renner, in his book Dressed to Kill, which this series is drawn from, provides this insight. He says, the reason the devil seems to rack up so many victories against the church is not because we lack power. The problem is because we lack commitment, organization, and discipline. Let's be honest. Where do you know you can and need to come up higher in these areas? What practical steps can you take to begin getting stronger in these areas? Well, yeah, time's getting short. Louis got another song here, I'm sure. So my thought was this, to sing this with the church today. But let me just leave you with this. When we choose to live holy and surrendered lives, we carefully guard our minds and equip ourselves with the whole armor of God. We become valuable and integral parts of God's church when we do this. And like the song says, onward Christian soldiers marching as to war. Just curious, how many know that song from way back when? Yeah, I think we've lost something because we're... Well, maybe not. The new songs are good too. Definitely the vast majority of people are knowing the new songs, which is great. But a lot of these old hymns have sermons in themselves. So let's close off in prayer. And I thank you for keeping me awake. Let's pray. Father, thank you for encouraging us through your word today. Please help us to stay focused on Jesus and on our work to further your kingdom. Help us to make our own hearts right before you and be the men and women after your own heart, just like David was. We know that when we put on the full armor of your Holy Spirit, and we know that we put on the full armor of God, your Holy Spirit will work in us to resist and conquer the devil and his demons. Help us not to just be listeners, but also doers of your word. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you. Thank you, Tony. What a great message. The song kind of just reflects beautifully on what Tony was talking about. In Christ alone, can we find our strength, and can we be properly armored by abiding in him and having Christ abide in us. So let's sing this together, church, and then I'll close in prayer.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground,
God, that is our prayer, and we thank you that no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck us from your hand. And God, we pray that as we are walking through this series, Lord, that you would help us put our full trust in you and abide in you, learn from you, and be equipped, Lord, with your armor. And we thank you that till Christ returns or calls us home, here in the power of Christ, that we can stand. In Jesus' name, amen.